Hello, welcome to this session on tuberculosis diagnosis and management. And this particular talk is on diagnosis of childhood TB. And I'm Dr. Varinder Singh from Lady Harding Medical College in Kalavati Sir and Children Hospital, Delhi, to take you through how to diagnose childhood TB. Before we get to the diagnosis, it's important to understand the natural history of childhood TB. There is usually a source case, an adult who is infective, and this source case exposes many of its contacts, which leads to a possibility of infection. Nearly 70% of the contacts perhaps will not gather an infection and therefore would not be prone to a disease, while another 30% would get infected. The risk of developing disease amongst those infected depends on several things, among which is the how recent this infection has been and the age of the child. Younger the child, higher is the risk of developing disease. So, a child who is below 5 years would have a risk of about 25%, and a younger infant may have a higher risk of about 50% of developing the disease, while the lifetime risk is only about 5 to 10%. Those who develop the disease after an infection usually will develop a primary disease, which can be either a smear positive or a smear negative or maybe an extrapulmonary disease. Amongst those who would not immediately develop a disease, they will have a persistent latent infection, which can later have a reactivation disease depending on the imbalance between mycobacterium virulence and host immunity, as signified by these two triangles. Why this is important to know is because children therefore are a good candidate for chemoprophylaxis, because they have a very high risk of developing disease after infection. That is why it is important to understand the natural history of childhood TB. With this background, it is also important to add that from infection to disease, it's almost like a continuum, and this continuum is like where the symptoms will come in. If you have symptoms which are initially very mild, this may just be a marker of infection which can undergo a spontaneous resolution. However, when this infection continues to produce a disease or pathology, there would be a progressive increase in symptoms, and that's the relevance of symptoms to differentiate between infection and a progressive disease. How do you diagnose childhood TB is another important point. We presume TB in children who have certain signs and symptoms, and among those, the most important sign and symptom is persistent cough or fever for more than 2 weeks duration. In addition to this, you could have a child who has a documented loss of weight or failure to thrive, or an unexplained severe malnutrition in an older child should always alert us toward a possibility of a background illness, of which TB in our milieu is very common. Is there a objective definition to loss of weight? Yes, one should use an objective definition, and that objective definition of loss of weight is loss of more than 5% body weight as compared to the highest weight recorded in past 3 months. That is important. The other symptoms which sometimes would signify underlying TB could be an unusual fatigue or lethargy, or a presence of peripheral swelling or lymph node which is persisting, or focal neurological signs or depressed consciousness. These sign symptoms are non-specific. However, if they continue to persist after an adequate dose of antibiotic therapy, course of antibiotic therapy, one should consider TB as a possibility, particularly in a child who has a documented TB exposure. As you would recall my slide on natural history of TB, children who are exposed and infected are at a higher risk of developing disease, and therefore this particular part of history becomes very important in suspecting or considering a presumptive case of TB, as they are called. Diagnosis of TB in children still remains a challenge, because many of these symptoms which I have alluded to in the past slide are common and non-specific. You see, chronic cough up to 20% of children from poor areas can very commonly have. Malnutrition or failure to gain weight is common with heavy worm infestation or with food insecurity. So, there is a need for accurate symptom definition. Let me elaborate this point by taking, say, cough as a symptom to describe. When a mother comes to you and says that my child has coughed for last 2 months, it could mean several things. To her, it could mean my child started having cough it increased and now is gradually decreasing but has not gone away. That's the green part of the chart as you see. Or it could mean it is a child who, this is a child who had cough for some days, was improving, again had another cough as is depicted by the purple line. Or it could be a child who could have continued to have cough which is gradually increasing as depicted by the red line. For a mom, all these three make cough for 2 months, but for a doctor it means very different things, as has been shown by the study from South Africa, where they said that if you have the purple pattern, then possibly you are dealing with more asthma like situations. If you have orange lines, then possibly you are dealing persistent symptoms, then you are dealing more with TB. So, remember these signs are dependent on the description of these symptoms or characterization is very important to consider what possibly diagnosis we are using. Once you have identified a presumptive case, how do you investigate this case further? That is important. What are the investigations which are available for diagnosis of TB in children? So, we start with this presumptive case who has persistent fever more than 2 weeks without a known cause and or unremitting cough or weight loss. In this child, your initial attempt would be to get a microbiological diagnosis through sputum, which is easy to come by in an older child, but not easy to come by in a younger child. So, a spontaneously expectorated sputum, an X-ray of the chest and a tuberculin skin test are amongst the first few TB specific investigations which you will consider. Once, if this comes out to be smear positive, then life becomes relatively easy because this possibly is a bacteriologically confirmed TB case in the given setting. However, if this does not come positive, then one has to rely on the other investigations, or if the smear comes negative or the child is not able to give you sputum because there is dry cough or child is young enough not to produce sputum. In all these scenarios, it is the X-ray which will direct the next steps. In the X-ray of the chest, we have described or classified the findings into two sets. One is X-ray of the chest which is highly suggestive of TB. Remember, it is highly suggestive, not diagnostic of TB. And what are those highly suggestive X-ray chest pictures? Let me share that with you. As I said in my first slide on natural history, that children often would have a primary disease. And when we say primary disease, what we are referring to is a lymph nodal component which you will get, which may be paratracheal or may be in the hilar area. So, this type of presentation is possible in the X-ray chest, which is highly suggestive of TB in our milieu in the given type of clinical presentation. So, this is right paratracheal and right hilar lymph node, which is suggestive of a primary TB. These component lymph nodal component may sometimes be associated with a parenchymal disease, as you can see here, or sometimes this parenchymal lesion may be more prominent than the lymph node component. In the previous X-ray, the parenchymal lesion was hazy, you had a definite right paratracheal node. In this X-ray, the node is on the contralateral side. It is possible to have contralateral lymph node disease along with a parenchymal lesion on the other side. So, this is also a suggestive of a primary complex. So, this is the paratracheal lymph node for you and the parenchymal lesion, as you can see. Sometimes there may be other suggestions. Here you see a child who has large supramediastinal widening, but you also compare the two sides. This side of the lung looks hyperinflated. Here the airway looks narrowed. This suggests that lymph node is having compression, and that's another sign which may be available seen in primary complex when the primary disease is progressing. The other then the hilar or paratracheal lymph node, the other highly suggestive form of chest X-ray finding is a chronic cavitary pneumonia. The term chronic comes from the history. It is long standing, it is not acute, it has not happened over last 2, 3, 4 days, because same cavitary pneumonia can happen with other necrotizing diseases like staphylococcal, where the child would have a very acute presentation. So, when you have a chronic presentation with a cavitary pneumonia, where the cavity may be standalone with little surrounding parenchymal involvement, or a cavity is a part of large consolidation, in a child with prolonged history, this is also considered quite suggestive of tuberculosis. So, here you see consolidation with a cavity or cavity within a consolidation. In older children, this may be part of an inhomogeneous opacity, as you can see here. there is a cavitary lesion and there is areas of breakdown within this consolidation. You may see this like a apical cavity with fibrosis which is pulling up this hyla, a chronic cavitary pneumonia with fibrosis which may be seen in adolescents because it's apical. This is the reactivation form of TB which can present like this. The third important radiological presentation which is suggestive of TB is miliary, which is like a snowstorm. You have miliary small micronodules about 2 millimeter which are scattered on both the lung fields equally, not sparing any area. They are quite suggestive of tuberculosis in our milieu. So, remember when we say specific or suggestive, not specific but highly suggestive forms of chest radiology, then it is lymphadenopathy with or without parenchymal lesion, it is miliary TB and it is chronic fibrocavitary pneumonia. So, when you have X-rays which is highly suggestive, going back to the algorithm which we started with, then you do sputum or a gastric aspirate or induced sputum. I will elaborate about these respiratory specimen as we go by, and you can use smear or CB naught depending on the facilities available. If you have a facility available for CB naught, also called as gene expert or expert RIF, that is a commercial name available, then you could do away with smear because it is much more sensitive than smear and there is no need to do smear in those situations. If it comes positive, it is a microbiologically or a bacteriologically confirmed case of TB. However, there may be a situation where this may come negative because these are not tests which are 100% sensitive. The sensitivity of gene expert is or smear is not more than 50%, smear is far lesser. So, you would have situations where this test will come negative, but you may not have any other likelihood, no alternative diagnosis. In this case, you may still consider this child to have TB and treat him as a clinically diagnosed case of TB. Now, let us change tacks and look at the other forms. You could have X-ray chest which shows non-specific shadows like a consolidation or inhomogeneous opacity. TST may be positive or sometimes negative. Here, there is a place for using a course of antibiotics. Use a course of and commonly used antibiotics are like amoxicillin you would use and see whether these persistent shadows disappear or not. If you do not have a response to antibiotics, then this is a child you would then subject to microbiological testing of the sputum or gastric aspirate or induced sputum for CB naught or smear depending on the facility. If it comes positive, again life is easy, but if it comes negative, this is a child who needs referral to an expert for further workup because here is a child who has a persistent pneumonia which has not responded to your antibiotic therapy and you need to see other causes including TB and therefore you need the help of an expert. The third situation could be that your TST is positive which shows that child has infection but X-ray is normal. If this child was symptomatic, this child merits evaluation for extrapulmonary TB and may be require a referral to an expert for further delineation. However, if your X-ray chest as well as TST are negative, then you have to look for alternative causes. These symptoms, though suggestive of TB, here this child may not be suffering from TB at all or may have something else. So, this is how we use this algorithm to make a diagnosis of childhood TB. But this algorithm comes with certain conditionalities. What are those conditionalities? First most important conditionality is that this child should not be a retreatment case or should not have received ATT prior to this or should not be a drug resistant TB suspect. Because in those situations, the microbiological tests come much earlier. The other thing is when we say weight loss or not gaining weight, it is very important to document it appropriately. In a city like Delhi or up north in India, where the winters can bring a load of 2 or 3 woolens, the difference of 5% can come only because of clothes. So, remember the child is weighed in minimal clothing each time and on the same weighing scale and these are not, the difference is not because of such errors. When it comes to the respiratory specimens, it is very important to know what samples are to be tested. It depends on the facilities you have. If you have facilities for smear only, then you would need at least 2 consecutive day samples. If you have facilities for CB naught, in which case you do not go for smear testing if there is an X-ray suggestion of TB, and here a single sample suffices and one does not need to repeat it. The other conditionality which comes to, as I said, just for repetition or reinforcement, I would say Remember the highly suggestive X-rays which refer to miliary, intrathoracic lymphadenopathy and a chronic fibrocavitary pneumonia. Non-specific shadows refer to consolidations or inhomogeneous shadows or bronchopneumonia, which can be because of several pathologies and therefore would require initially a course of antibiotic before we decide to investigate this child for pneumonia. It's a non-response to antibiotic in this situation, which makes them more likely to be suffering from tuberculosis. Remember that. And equally important, remember, when you are using this course of antibiotic, do not use a set of antibiotic like linezolids or linezolid or quinolone, because these have anti-TB effect. So if you are seeing a benefit with antibiotic, you should be using an antibiotic which is not likely to have an effect on TB. So avoid. One should not use linezolid or quinolone as a course of antibiotic for deciding this persistent pneumonia. And it's equally important to remember all TB cases when diagnosed must be offered testing for HIV, because these can coexist.